Good morning. Thank you all for coming, and I'm proud to sort of be the organizer of Roaming Cats here with this great panel of really diverse, interesting, and distinctive personalities, not only the brands that they represent, but also themselves as leaders and visionaries of their brands. One of the things I think is going to be interesting about this session is that while a lot of us think about consumer-focused efforts, I think one of the things that each of these brands have done in a really unique way is make an inspiring, interesting, and satisfying workplace for their associates. And in some cases, because these brands are really very much focused on being experiential brands, the physical environment, the product, but also the people end up being one of the most important elements. So I think today's session will give you some ideas around that area as well. So what makes things memorable? If you're thinking about today the importance of social media and content, you know, today the store environment is one of the most important places. It's kind of the red carpet. And it's also the background for people from a standpoint of creating their own social content. You know, think of each photograph that a customer takes in your store and of a memorable experience or moment within that space and translates that into social media. It's some of the best marketing and ambassadorship we can have. And I think each of these brands in their own way have really made their shopping experience memorable. We're gonna talk about three main areas. One is this idea of passion. And I think as you hear Matey speak, is that passion comes from within. It's not a passion that's manufactured or it's a passion that has been created by a bunch of copywriters. It's authentic, it's real. I'll tell you a bit about the story with Robert Redford and the Sundance, the amazing Sundance property, which the brand draws its inspiration from. But there's a passion for that, and that passion goes back and beyond just the people that touch and operate that brand today. If you look at place, you know, one of the things David will share with you a bit about how they have a very different vision about how many stores are the right number of stores for DXL. But what hasn't changed is a committed passion for the place, how the place influences the customer, and how the synergy of the digital environment and the environment of place really creates a 1+1=3 proposition. And then last, personality, and I think Lauren will own the stage as part of this presentation. Lauren is a innovator, founder, disruptor, personality, all wrapped into one, and a person of many personas. One thing she was sharing with me today, she has a whole wardrobe of costumes and wigs that she pulls out at a moment's notice and it is New Orleans. You know, I was telling her today she probably would be out of place in New Orleans. The people would look at her with suspicion, but not as you'll see in her presentation, that she is a very free spirit in a world and an environment that loves and celebrates the free spirit. So I think today we'll talk a little bit about authentic stories. These are all brand stories with emotional power. Memorable experiences, because a story, it's kind of the tree falls and no one hears it. Did the tree really make a sound? Each of these brands in their own unique way have created a sound in the forest that their consumer has heard. Particularly in this environment where I think most of us have read articles over the last few weeks about people who are failing, brands like The Limited, who really have built the suburban shopping mall, is no longer gonna be in existence in the way that they were. And really the moments of delight, I think that's critical in the presentations, because while these are people with strong business and strategic objectives, they're also not afraid, and if anything, they seek out the ability to make their brand and their environments be experiential. And then in the end, how do you make this meaningful connection? Because we all know that in a digital world, the aspects of real time and touch is not something that necessarily you can effectively communicate in that digital platform. On the other hand, the physical place and the passion and the personality are all ways that we make a connection, and a human connection, which is even more critical in this digital world that we live in. And so I'd like to ask Matey to come up and share a bit about the Sundance story. For those who speak to Matey afterwards, you're gonna be very jealous of her amazing accessories, and I think you'll see how the accessories and artists and craftspeople so figure into the Sundance story. Matey?
Thank you, Ken. It's an absolute honor to be here on behalf of Sundance. My name is Matey Erdos, and over the last 18 months, we have opened 5 beautiful new stores under a new design concept. Each store captures the ethos of Sundance through authenticity, creativity, and storytelling. We've been very successful with driving traffic to our stores with no markdowns, really a nod towards a very thoughtful merchandising strategy, in-store navigation, and keeping a very high bar in the brand experience that Sundance is known for. There's no place quite like Sundance. We create an experience not commonly found elsewhere. Since our inception, we've been very successful in providing a platform for artisans and bringing art and commerce together in a very meaningful manner. For over 25 years, we've remained committed to our founder's vision of curating an experience that enables our customers to express their authenticity and originality through our product, and we're consistent with that across all channels. Sundance is an authentic, aspirational lifestyle brand. We're a real person, we're a real place. Mesmerized by the beauty of Utah's natural landscape, Robert Redford founded discovered Sundance in 1969. Sundance, the place, serves as a natural host to inspire creativity, new discovery, independence, and freedom. At the base of the village is a general store, which still is there today, showcasing artisans and their crafts. And due to that large success, he launched a catalog in 1989. Over 25 years later, we've become a beloved and coveted national retailer. To inspire creativity is the core of our culture. It's our DNA, it's what we do, it's how we breathe every day down the halls of Sundance. We believe that making room for artisans, emerging talent, and their stories has a lasting value and enables our customer to be part of something greater. An emotional connection is made, and it takes the brand experience beyond a transaction.
Something happens to me when I go into the forest. It's a time where I can just get really real, get balanced, find my true essence of who I really am. This cuff was actually completely inspired by my visit in the Great Bear Rainforest in British Columbia. It was probably one of the most peaceful times I've ever had. And that's where I feel most comfortable. Having a canopy of these beautiful old growth trees and feeling the wisdom of the forest, that's what inspires me the most to create pieces of jewelry. I brought that essence of how I felt back into my studio, and I created this cuff for Sundance. They totally understand the essence of life. It's those little things. For 17 years I've been with Sundance, and it's been the most beautiful relationship because I feel like my inspiration has come from following my heart, putting my inspirations into my jewelry that are then spread to thousands and thousands of people through Sundance. So they support, on the bigger picture, the ability to live a life that we choose. To have a partner like that is a complete blessing. I designed my Amore Vitae cuff in honor of Sundance's 20th anniversary, as I believe the essence of that cuff is also the essence of Sundance.
This past year, we celebrated 20 years since the launch of our dedicated jewelry catalog, which was launched in 1996. It's dedicated to artisans. It's artists like Jess Mahari and hundreds of others, other artists that we support. They illustrate a deep passion to create and to inspire through storytelling. Storytelling engages and inspires, it fascinates, it provokes. A sense of discovery through storytelling drives engagement and brings a halo effect to the entire in-store experience. Since our humble beginnings as a general store, our collection has grown quite vastly through women's apparel, footwear, accessories, jewelry, and home decor. Each category represents the artistic and sophisticated and casual lifestyle of Sundance. Our women's apparel offers a casual elegance, artisanal designs and classic silhouettes inspired by vintage patterns and novelty. We're known for our jewelry. Over 95% of our jewelry is exclusive to Sundance. Genuine stones, natural materials, and many one of a kind. We give our customers the full head-to-toe look, representing the casual lifestyle of Sundance through handcrafted footwear, boots, belts, and handbags. And our dedication to community-minded artisans permeates through our home decor category as well, which really rounds out the lifestyle of Sundance, the place. Over 25 years, the company has really transformed from a small little store to a print catalog to a multi-channel digital experience, now moving very quickly towards an omni-channel experience. We launched the catalog, as I mentioned, in 1989, the jewelry catalog in 1996, and we started our first two stores in 7 and 8, and we just recently launched 5 beautiful stores under a new design concept across the country, moving from west to the east coast. We are very, very strong in the direct-to-consumer space. We have an immense amount of data that really has guided and informed us, and we are very excited about pushing forward brick and mortar to the tune of 40 stores by 2020. Bringing the beauty and the authenticity into the in-store experience is personally very, very rewarding. It's an amazing lifestyle, and bringing that into the four walls of a store is pretty tremendous. The stores bring a very strong sense of discovery, a sense of place, a sense of community, a sense of gathering. The stores are deeply grounded in the culture and the history and the values of Sundance. They offer an experience not commonly found elsewhere.
There's nothing out there quite like Sundance. It's freedom, independence, creativity. It's not the ordinary. It's really extraordinary. We take great pride in curating in a very special assortment. It's unfounded. It's something they haven't seen before. When I walked into the store, I was just unbelievably overwhelmed with the beauty. There's a strong sense of discovery. Every turn that you make, there's a sense of surprise and excitement. We've been very true to that one vision Mr. Redford had, and that's providing a platform for the artisan community. We've never lost sight of that, and to this day, we're just as committed to that as we were from the beginning. Through our catalog and our website, and now through our retail experience, we're portraying that lifestyle for our customers. The beauty of the store is actually bringing that to life.
A very key part of that brand experience that I'm describing are our associates. They are the brand experience. They're deeply steeped in the heritage and the values of Sundance. They're passionate. They're driven by the stories. They want to converse with the customer, not just transact. They bring the experience beyond a transaction, which really is key. The minute you walk into the store, their passion is just, it's so obvious, it's so contagious. Bringing the human element into the stores and having our customers actually meet the artists has been tremendous. This was a test, and we wanted to see the value of that engagement, and it was incredibly successful. Having a conversation, touching the product, learning about their inspiration really has a halo effect on the entire assortment and the experience. Social media also has enabled us to share that experience across the country to our customers who are not in the trade area, and the engagement and the buzz is just tremendous. We absolutely support the local art communities, those nonprofits that are aligned with a similar vision that we have in supporting art education, and in particular youth education. And I can't begin to tell you how valuable this is, where customers come in, they thank you and say thank you for supporting the arts. And we continue that relationship on an ongoing basis. Our vision is omni-channel. As I mentioned, we're very, very steeped in the direct-to-consumer arena. We have invested in a database, customer database, that's enabling us to have a 360-degree view of our customer no matter where she is. We know our channels are not discrete. We know our customers want Sundance wherever they are, whether through a mobile device or on the phone, through a catalog or in the store, and we intend to be there and market to her and message to her directly. So we're very, very excited by that. Sundance is a creatively charged company. I mean, everything we do is about creativity. We do not rest on our laurels. We're always giving our customers something new, something they haven't seen. We're always delighting them and surprising them, and we never lose our passion to create an experience not commonly found elsewhere. How do we know we are successful? When I walk into a store and customers stop and talk and shake my hand and say thank you. Thank you for this experience. Thank you for making it personal. Thank you for creating an experience that just you can't find elsewhere in the marketplace. I feel it's the in-store experience that we've created that really sets Sundance apart. Thank you.
Thank you, Matey. You know, I think in the Sundance stores, it's interesting, having been there and talked to people, they talk about having their Sundance time. And they come into the shopping mall or the environment, and they, of course, they're going to shop, but their purpose is really to have their time in that aura. And it's really interesting to hear those comments.
To share it.
David will be presenting next from DXL. I think one of the things that's been most interesting from my perspective of DXL is in creation of a place. There aren't too many retail brands that might have a linebacker from an urban high school to a grandfather who probably spends his time fishing or going to a ball game, to have a Wall Street executive who shops at Saks and Neiman's, or to have a customer who is perfectly at home at their local Walmart. And David is, and his team have built a really interesting place where all those people find common ground and find a great experience. So David, if you'll share that with us, I appreciate it.
Well, thank you, Ken. Just to start off with a little history about the company. In 2002, I was CEO of a company called Designs, and we had 100 Levi and Docker outlet stores east of the Mississippi. We were a public company. The stock had gone from $25 down to $1. The Levi business, which was a $6 billion business, was going down to $4 billion, and we were one of the largest distributors. We needed an exit plan. A company called Casual Mail, Big and Tall, was bankrupt, and we went to an auction. We bought it. We figured this is a nice niche business. It had gone bankrupt twice, but we figured, what options did we have? Had we continued on our course, we would have gone into bankruptcies ourselves. Well, this is what we bought. Not a very pretty picture. As you could see, we were called Casual Mail and Big and Tall, but the signage really said Big and Tall, so we were called the Big and Tall, and had certainly a lot of problems with that. We went through focus groups, and gee whiz, what did the guy say? I hate being called Big and Tall. He has the same vanity issues that women have if they were called plus size. Well, it didn't get a whole lot better when you walked into the store. And this is what we inherited. And again, it was horrific, claustrophobic. The dressings were small. You could see a guy of size couldn't possibly walk through those aisles. You couldn't possibly wardrobe yourself and put together any type of outfit. And that experience, you know, it's just basically a big yuck. We also did some remodeling. We spruced things up. We changed the name from Casual Mail Big and Tall to Casual Mail XL. We hired George Foreman. That was in the height of the grill. We had all this traffic coming in. We actually had a 9% comp increase that year. But guess what? They never came back again, obviously for this experience that we were giving them. So what happened is, here's what was going to our company. We started to erode. The stores, the sales kept coming down, and looks like we were going to be bankruptcy number three along the way. So we went back to the drawing board. We brought in focus groups. He said, tell us about your DXL perception. What do you think about this company? And basically, it's your dad's store. It's a guy who wears Hawaiian shirts, elastic waistbands. Meanwhile, this is what we were actually selling, so we deserved what we got. But lack of style, limited selection, and there's also perception that we were expensive, because big and tall clothing does naturally cost a little bit more money. And the environment itself was no better. We were located in strip centers. Our co-tenancy would have been a check cashing place, maybe a slice of pizza place, but just a miserable retail environment, and it was very difficult to shop, and you had that whole stigma, big and tall. Nobody wanted to admit they were going to walk in there. I think they walked in with their head down and having a pair of sunglasses on so they wouldn't be noticed. So what was the opportunity for us? Well, what we decided, we looked at big and tall as two different segments. You know, the natural size curve of a guy, like everybody else, the peak sizes are going to be, you know, 34, 36, 38. And our average size was 50 and 52. So what we did, if you had a 52-inch waist, boy, we own the guy. Where else is he going to shop? But that tail was very small. So there was a trough, because if you go to traditional retailers and shop the mall, you're going to see it pretty much ends at 40. So you've got this this trough of like guys who are kind of in the middle. We call him the end of the rack. He's got a 40. If you have a 42-inch waist and you're a guy, you go to the mall, you're going to find nothing. You may find one pair of khaki pants. So there was this huge opportunity in there to get this guy in our stores. But this guy does not think at all he's big and tall. Look, I don't think I'm as old as I look. We all have that same self-perception. But this guy was never going to come into one of our stores. But here's where the difference was. It was that trough, that guy, let's say 42 to 46, is 70% of the entire big and tall business. And in our stores, it was 25%. So this guy was neither here nor there. He couldn't shop the department stores. He couldn't shop, would never come into casual mail. So there was this huge opportunity for us to get into that business. So what did we learn from all this? This was the solution. Start all over again. Start from scratch. So we embarked on a strategy that has never been done in the history of retail. It wasn't a matter of repainting, carpeting, trying to spruce up the stores. We basically decided we're going to close 400 casual mail stores and create a new concept, a new brand that doesn't have the baggage of being casual mail, and start all over again. And we created this brand called DXL. Now, tremendous risk to do this, and tremendous expense. This project was going to cost us $200 million over time, and we didn't have any cash to start with. So in 2010, we came out with this new concept. And today, DXL is really the only retailer that truly gets our guy. We put the wow in his shopping experience by offering a unique one-stop shop. We make him look and feel good. And I hope this video gives you kind of an essence of what the DXL brand is today. So we created this from our own focus groups and surveys and everything. We gave this guy what he wanted. What does he want? He wanted to be able to shop in one store and have a selection of product that could fit those needs. The average size of a casual mail store was 3,500 square feet. The average size of a DXL is over 7,000 square feet. We gave him that selection. Give him a dressing room where he can move around in. Wider aisles, have a tailor on site. We had none of the above. So what we found is that we had to build a concept, a store that would meet those guys' needs. Now here's where it gets interesting. If you ask somebody who's your customer, you're going to say, oh, he's 25 to 35. He's 40 to 60 years old. Well, our customer can be 18, 40, 80. We could have the father and the son come in the same store. The only thing they have in common is the fact that they're of size. He could be making $30,000 a year. He could be making $1 million a year. We get stuck. We got to cover all those, that whole spectrum. So we can't build a store that's going to have shirts over here and have pants over here. We have to do it, but we created it by lifestyle. And this is actually a little plug for Ken. Ken was the architect that presented the plan for the layout of the store, and I brought this one back because it really is important. But guys do shop by lifestyle, so a guy could walk in the room, in the store, he could be an active player, he could be young men's, he could be looking for a suit. Again, we cover all the things kind of in a racetrack formation. So they will splinter off two different guys coming in the store. And the beauty of this, when we presented it to this guy, and I've seen this happen many times, I have seen guys walk in the store, they literally stop in their tracks, try to absorb what's happening, we settle them down and understand that this guy is experiencing something special. I've seen guys actually tear up and goes, thank you, thank you, thank you. We've been very neglected in what we've been able to shop compared to other guys, so it's been a big win for us. And one of the wins for us is the selection of brands we brought in. Today we have over 100 brands out there. We couldn't get arrested to get a brand in our store, but today every store has a Polo Ralph Lauren shop like you would find in a Nordstrom's or a Macy's. We have Brooks Brothers, we have Calvin Klein, we have Michael Kors, we got Lucky, we got Lacoste, we got True Religion. None of these products were ever made in big and tall sizes, and they weren't going to do it. We got them, all these brands, to walk into our DXL store and they go, I'm sold, I want to be part of this experience. And it's been phenomenal because these guys, especially these end of the rack guys, suddenly outgrow their ability to wear the brands that they wanted to wear before, and this has been an absolute home run for us. So let's move on to the results of what's happened to our company in the last several years. Well, being a national brand, we had to have some critical mass to actually go out and market on a national level. So we had 50 stores in 2013. We figure, okay, here's enough. Let's go out and build a brand. And at that time, the brand awareness, aided awareness, have you ever heard of us? Only basically 1 out of 10 big and tall guys have even heard of DXL when we started the national campaign. Casual male was at 42%. Well, again, it's been around for 25 years, but even that was not that exciting. So we needed something important. We needed a breakthrough. And as I was talking about this end of the rack guy, let's put a commercial together that he's going to connect to and resonate with, and let's create something special about it. And this was the first national commercial that we ran.
What is this place? I was just back there shopping.
Did you find anything?
Well, I found this shirt, but I can't find any pants that fit.
Good luck with that.
Finally, something in my size. Gloves!
Hey, look at Tom. He found an entire outfit.
Stop shopping in no man's land. There's a better way for bigger men to find clothes. Destination XL, big on being better.
So what happened to our awareness? We went from that 13% to last year, we ended the year at 40% awareness, which is a great increase, but it's still a huge opportunity for us in the future because 6 out of 10 guys who are big and tall or the end of the rack have still never heard of us. So we've got a lot of blue sky ahead of us to continue to create that awareness. And here comes the big win that we didn't even know was going to be such a windfall. So this end of the rack customer, this guy who is 42 to 46, he spends 120% more than the guy who is 48 and above that we had before. And he shops over 50% more often than the customer we had before. This was the holy grail. So when I talked about this opportunity, it's really obviously been very successful. This guy now has a home, and that whole frustration of not being able to find anything is going away. So our future opportunities. We've been rolling out these stores since 2010. We started with 4 stores, then we added 12 stores, the next year 32 stores, over 50 stores. Meanwhile, converting and collapsing all these stores. We're closing the casual male store in the old strip center. We could be moving it 5 miles away because retail has changed. The lifestyle center has moved over here. And so we had to clear out all our real estate. We've been doing it as the leases come due. And we continue to we opened 30 stores this year. So today we have 203 of these stores done at a cost of like $100 million. It's been an amazing journey, 6 years of this to get there. We still got more expansion coming. We'll be opening 20 to 30 stores a year for the next several years. Next March we open in Canada and Toronto, our first 2 stores. We believe we've got an international story. It's a global story. There's nothing like what we have. Everything out there that exists today would be strictly a mom and pop. So this is truly a transformation, never been done before. We're well over the hump. And now we have positive cash flow. We took on a lot of debt to get this thing done. and now we're self-funding the future growth. So just in closing, I'd just like to say, when things don't happen right away, you just remember, it takes 6 months to build a Rolls Royce and 13 hours to build a Toyota. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, David. I think you can see, I suggest you, if you have a chance to visit one of the DXL stores, and I think you can see if you're a big and tall customer, and not just a big and tall customer, but an active customer, a fashionable customer, motivated customer, that you'll feel like you've come home when you open up those doors. So I think David and his team have done a great job.
Thank you.
I had the pleasure of meeting Lauren a few years ago, and she comes from probably a place that's known for both its passion and its place. It's New Orleans, and there's probably no city that's more iconic in the world than New Orleans is. Food, Mardi Gras right now. Probably half people don't know they're even in New Orleans right
that's
now, right?
Right.
Waking up this morning. And Lauren really embodies that sense of personality and how personality, not only the place that she chooses as her home, but also her own personality, really has become an integral part of her very successful business. So Lauren, if you'll share some of your stories with us, we appreciate it.
All right. How y'all doing this morning? That's how we talk in New Orleans. It's not just in movies. My name's Lauren Haydell, and I am the CEO and T-shirt folder, also Big Chief, that's a Mardi Gras Indian word, of Fleurty Girl. It's all about personality, place, product, all those things, passion, and Fleurty Girl really does center around all of that. But I want to take you on a journey of how it all came to be. It's not your average city, New Orleans. How many of y'all been there? Obviously I've been there, but wow, nice job. It's not your average city, and I'm not your average CEO. I was going to wear this today, but it was snowing, there was snow on the ground, you know, I figured that might not have been good. But that's New Orleans. We're not afraid to let loose and have fun. This was for charity. I don't just walk around the shop like this. This was a Bodacious Bras auction and was heavily branded, as you can see. But I wasn't always Fleurty Girl. I'm going to take you back to 2009. I was a single mother of three kids living paycheck to paycheck. My house is going into foreclosure. I was struggling to make ends meet, and I just never saw myself that way. I really thought there was supposed to be more. I was turning into my mother. So I decided I was going to do something with my life. I was going to take my income tax refund check of $2,000 and print a bunch of T-shirts. I was behind on my mortgage, really not the smartest decision, right? But I had an idea for a T-shirt line that celebrated the city that I love, New Orleans. So I did it. I took that $2,000, printed a bunch of T-shirts, and I had no money, so really that $2,000 just went just to print the T-shirts for the blanks and the printing. I had a friend who was a really good illustrator, and she liked an armoire that I had in my house, so we bartered. So that's how I got the artwork done for the first several T-shirts. It was terrifying. That's our first shirts getting printed and our shirts on a store shelf in New Orleans. It took off so quickly. I used social media. I built a website myself, and I sold out of that initial inventory in just 30 days. I still had my full-time job, and my boss was very adamant. He said, "I don't want you doing any Fleurty Girl work while you're here at your job." Totally understandable. In addition to selling out of my first round of shirts in the first 30 days, the Saints were having a really good season back in 2009. It was the perfect year to start a T-shirt line that celebrated New Orleans. This is what had become of our kitchen table at home. T-shirts were everywhere. Bags of, you know, T-shirt orders are on the ground. And people really wanted a brick and mortar store. Well, this is just 6 months after I'd started my company, and I was able to pull my house out of foreclosure, so I was able to stay afloat, but it's like, well, now what do? I need to have a store. So I found this little shop that I could rent in New Orleans so that people could come in and try on their shirts and have that sort of in-store experience and feel that New Orleans feeling. It was literally smaller than this stage. The kids and I lived in the back. They went from having their own room to sharing one room, and our front of the house was the shop, and people would come in and shop right there in my house. Sometimes my kids would be rocking around in their pajamas on a Saturday, but it's what we needed to do, and it was real, and it was authentic, and I love New Orleans, and so people really got that passion for the place. So I told y'all that the Saints were having a really good season that year. It was such a good year that the NFL sent me a cease and desist letter that said I can't sell things that say who dat, which really bothered me because I've been a Saints fan my whole life and nobody ever cared about using phrases on shirts for the Saints until we were heading to the Super Bowl. I kept my full-time job. I was still trying to do both at the same time. And somebody had sent a message on Twitter because they had gone into my shop and not seen any of the who dat t-shirts on the shelves. Well, I quietly went to the bathroom. You can actually send a 140-character tweet in the amount of time it takes you to go to the bathroom. I was a master at that. So I quickly responded to the customer's tweet while at work and just said, I got a cease and desist letter from the NFL. I can't sell who dat t-shirts. Within 1 hour, all the news stations were calling the front desk of my job looking for me. My boss is livid. This is what happened that day. I left work, I told my boss, I said, I'm gonna clean this up and I will be back here tomorrow. This is New Orleans in a nutshell, especially with our Saints team. Don't mess with us. Don't tell us that we can't print our fan phrase. So what it did was, nobody in New Orleans wanted licensed NFL apparel. Everyone in New Orleans wanted a Fleurty Girl shirt. I still had a full-time job and three kids and this is all happening out of the front of my house. So the next day I woke up and I promised my boss that I would be at work. I was on the front page of the newspaper. Good Morning America was calling, ESPN. They all wanted to come for interviews because the Saints were heading to the Super Bowl, so those sort of stories were relevant to the nation. That was the day I quit my job. I worked it as long as I could. I had a company car, they came and took that. I had a company cell phone, they came and took that. Talk about scary. People were going nuts. This was my shop. I could not print the shirts fast enough. And then we did it. The Saints won the Super Bowl. So we kept on selling more shirts. People just loved our brand. And I opened more stores. So 6 months from starting the company, I opened my first store. 6 months after that, I opened an additional store. So every 6 months after that, I opened three more. I eventually moved out of the house that I was living in so that the kids could have their own room because that was like senior trip in Cancun every night of the week, trying to get three kids in one room to go to sleep. So we moved really quickly. People just loved us. They would get so excited when we were coming into their part of New Orleans. This is one of our stores today in Metairie. If you look all the way in the back of this photo, you can actually see I built a fake facade of the front house where I started the company, where our customers had originally started shopping with us. We expanded beyond t-shirts. We sell all things that celebrate New Orleans. And I try to get as many products that are made by New Orleanians that are kind of going through the same thing that I was going through back in 2009. We had a lady who worked at a furniture store and she made these really cute dish towels with different sayings. And we've done so much business for her. Now she does this full time. We've helped her buy a house, helped her buy a car, and we've got that kind of story with a lot of other locals. In addition to having lots of great products and lots of great in-store experiences, I also do videos for the city of New Orleans to promote tourism. So it sort of aligns our brand with that. People call me Fleurty Girl. I think a lot of people that shop with me, they don't all know my real name. It's, hey, Fleurty Girl. Oh, hey, how's your mom and them? That's kind of how it goes. And then just being involved in the city of which you're passionate about. That's the picture on the bottom. That's that's on Bourbon Street. The Friday before Mardi Gras, they give us jars of Vaseline. They choose four local girls. And we grease the poles with Vaseline so that people can't climb up them on Mardi Gras Day and hurt themselves and fall and bust their head open on Bourbon Street. It's the greatest city in the world, I'm telling you. So that's the kind of fun stuff that Fleurty Girls get to do. I've been in business, this will be our eighth year. We have six retail locations. We just acquired the company that we started selling our shirts in recently. And I've never taken out a loan. That $2,000 is what sustains us today. We're a multi-million dollar company now. And everybody said I was crazy. My parents said I was crazy. And now they both work for me. So that's really been satisfying, especially when mom sends her a vacation request and you have to say, whoops, I've already booked mine for that week. Sorry, mom. Just last year, I was featured on the Harry Connick Jr. show. I don't know if y'all are familiar with who he is, but he's a New Orleans boy too, so that was really fun. It's really fun to get to share the story because I had no time, no money, but I had a passion for New Orleans and the personality to go along with it. And I worked all through high school and college for Nine West Group, so I knew retail better than anything else. Just recently got married. I had to throw this in there because I'm proud. I'm excited. He's a great guy. He's a baker in New Orleans, so if y'all are ever down there, come to Fleurty Girl and Haydell's Bakery. And that was his groom's cake, my girl, which I thought was so sweet. But Fleurty Girl is a brand that lives and breathes in New Orleans, and we are everything that we want our customers to feel. When I first started the company, I had applied to be in an incubator program, and I remember the guy had told me, he said, why do you have all these other girls in your shirts? How come you're not modeling your shirts? I didn't think I was model material, but it was really the best advice that he could give me was to be my brand. You are Fleurty Girl, Lauren. You need to be her. And that really set the stage for the whole company and how we operate. It is something that is so unique and special, but it is, I want other girls to be Fleurty Girls too, where it's okay to ride your bike wearing a tutu. That's the kind of stuff we do. We'll sell you the tutu. We've got those too. So that's Fleurty Girl. I'd love for y'all to come and visit. It's been 8 years. We have 5 stores, just opened a 6th. And that's just how we roll. Laissez le bon temps rouler.
Thank you. I think you can see from Lauren that that this whole concept of personality is not an abstract; it's a reality. So, just kind of recapping, if you kind of look at all this and you try to put it together, I think one of the things that's happening a lot is what used to be is the what is now about the how, and the how might be the creation of place, it might be the communication of passion, and it might be the sharing of personality. We think this is really the big change that's happened over the last few years, obviously, within retail. But these brands, I think, are all great examples of that. And if we start to look at that, then from a standpoint, if I can just find the down arrow here, is the creation of social media, content, the shareability of the brand, all these three attributes really allow the customers, your customers and your ambassadors, to become the best advocates of the brand. And it's really about the passion, the place, and the personality. In looking at your own passion, personality, and place, what do you think is really the hardest to deliver on? And maybe, David, maybe I'll ask you the first since you're in the middle here.
Well, I didn't realize the challenge would be to change just by changing our name. Getting that awareness level up is so critical. Guys aren't great shoppers. They don't pay a lot of attention. And even when we would put a new store in town in the early years, it would take a couple years just to get back the customers that we had in the old format. But it's word of mouth, it's social media, it's the marketing, it's all these things. You have to invest in your brand to create that awareness level.
And Matey, how do you keep the passion going? You shared a lot of examples of how you succeeded, but how do you make the donuts?
Yeah, I think the Sundance brand is just known for its creative presence and making sure that we're consistent with that experience as you walk through the doors. And as I mentioned, it's really through the associates and the photography and just the navigation of that sense of discovery.
And an everyday effort.
An everyday effort, yeah. Keeping it fresh and new.
And Lauren, with now that you've looked back 8 years, what's an eight years look like? Because, you know, it's the being the fresh face is one thing, staying the fresh face is the other. How do you think you do that and deliver?
I think we just keep going and keep going to Mardi Gras and listening to our customers. Maybe mm-hmm. an airport store would be really fun to be a part of that mm-hmm. one day. But I have a daughter who's 12 and who is in the brand and loves to help with the shops when she can. And she's actually been helpful too from the tween side. We've incorporated that into the store to try to capture that customer now also.
So, to make the family at both ends work for you,
a destination flirty girl.
Yeah. And Tina, are there questions? I see a hand raised over here. Oh, I'm sorry, I think we are out of time. I'll ask the panel maybe to hang around for a few minutes and speak to anybody who has a question, but thank you very much.
Thank you.